Dad?
Oh, yeah?
Why is the kettle boiling in the shed?
Well, I wouldn't mind a cup of tea, actually, Jake. What about that? No, actually, you mentioned the other day about new and modern materials, and I know that they use special oils that are magnetic in certain engines, Jake. So I thought it would be lovely for me to perhaps pass on some of my research, but both to you and the viewers. And this clip, on the next couple of clips, is all about modern and smart materials. And in some cases, just materials that are new and in some way enhance, in that they are perhaps a little bit special over some of the materials we have been talking about. So I'm going to show you a few quite interesting facts, and we can do a few experiments, starting with the kettle. Shall I put that in there, Jake?
Yeah.
Make a weird cup of tea out of plastic.
Wow.
Ooh, let's see what happens. Now this, I think, is what they call polymorph. It's a new type of plastic made from, it's called caprolactones. Caprolactones, all very slow. It reacts to heat between 60 and 65 degrees. And as you can see, oh, is it going soft? Yes, it is. Look, it's going transparent there. And it's going soft. And guess where you see these?
In this bowl of water.
Right. What about perhaps people having something like that in their mouth when they're playing rugby?
Oh, those gum shields
thingies. It's the smart gum shields. So you can form it to shape into your mouth when your mouth's slightly warm. And as it cools, it forms around your teeth, providing a really protective gum shield. And this is polymorph, that's one to remember. Poly, what do you think that means? What's poly?
It's got polymers in it.
Yes, yeah, so it's a plastic. And this is becoming a liquid or a softened plastic from a solid plastic. So in a minute, we'll pull that out. Now, I'm going to show you something else, Jake. What do you think is going to happen to this cup when I fill it with hot water?
I think it will just... Well, nothing, really.
I forgot the tea bag, Jake.
Oh.
Keep an eye on that, Jake. I think, oh, good grief. Look at that, let's turn the light off. Look.
Wow. Yeah,
look. How strange, it's all coming up here, look. Can you see that, guys?
That's amazing.
Yeah, very clever. What does it say on it? La, tickle, tickle? A bit strange.
Oh, something like that.
I don't know what that is. Anyway, so going back to our polymorph here. Let's put some hot, so there, look. That'll go cold now. Well, it's not cold, and then it will go dark like that one. It's another cup, look. Oh, there's some funny powder in there we'll go back to.
Is that flour?
No, it looks like powder, but it's not. It's a special type of plastic which expands. Talk about that in a minute. Yeah, so polymorph remains at liquid room temperature at 4 degrees. There's some liquid polymorph, look. Yeah. A bit like mercury, really, which is, I know, a metal, and this is a polymer, but it's liquid at room temperature, that type. Liquid polymorph. Clever stuff, really. But that's a plastic. Okay, so moving back to here. Look, there we go. If I can pick that up, I don't really want to, but it's clearly... Oh, weird.
Quite literally clear.
It is clearly a plastic, and I can make that into pretty well any shape I like. If I heated it even longer, it'd go completely transparent. But yeah, that's a plastic. You can make a mold out of that, couldn't you?
Mm.
You could form that round a screwdriver and make a hollow mold to pour in maybe a liquid resin for later. Or maybe if you wanted to make a special ergonomic screwdriver handle, we'll stick that on there, leave it like that. My ergonomic handle that fits just around my hand, Jake. Right, we'll leave that there and see what happens. Right, okay, so we'll go back to the viewers a minute on perhaps this. This is a special, what they call quantum tunnelling material. And it's a composite, which means it's made up from more than one material. Usually to make an enhancement, that's about 6 or 7 volts. Can you see that? Can you see that, guys? Jake, if you just pan onto that, and that's a UV ultraviolet LED illuminating, in this case, can you get that? Not so bright, is it?
No.
Illuminating some optic fibres here. Okay, and optic fibres are a special new material, almost a smart material. Can handle lots of data. Optic fibres can transmit light as data over very long distances, hundreds of miles, and the data is not lost, it's all precise. So that is QTC material, this stuff, and it the resistance varies depending on the pressure you put in. I can see, I can press that, and the resistance varies. Okay, so that's a little bit there. Lights on again, Jake. We have also, let's just pan across actually, we'll go through all these in a minute, but let's start off, Jake, with some of my research. So we'll come back to you in a minute, viewers. So going back to our research, guys, we're looking at smart materials today and new materials, and you've got a whole range of them. The research is extremely complicated, so I urge you, if you get a moment, to perhaps go online and look at some of these individual examples, perhaps on YouTube clips, or just type it in Google. I got lenticular sheet, and that's a very clever piece of plastic they use in security and all sorts. And you have polymorph, we've discussed. Some materials, as you know, allow the colour changing on a battery. So you actually press something and the chemical or the voltage and difference in the battery, the potential difference from one side to another, allows the colour to change. Same you get in kettles, don't you? And you get those in thermometers, I noticed, don't you, Jake?
Mm-hmm.
And watches that illuminate with light and ultraviolet and so forth. All smart materials, you've got polymorph, that we've looked at. Very clever. Yeah, very clever. QTC tunnelling foam, which we've looked at. So worth looking at that, guys. Liquid polymorph, we've looked at. Smart putty, that was that stretchy stuff. Do you remember, Jake, this stuff?
Yeah.
This rubber. It's a rubber. Well, it's actually a plastic, but you can form it into,
whoa,
as you can see, a putty. And still elastic.
Wow.
And then it'll form back into its shape. Dead easy, and still a rubber. But that is actually a polymer.
Wow.
Go back to that in a minute, Jake. Ferrofluid, this is the one you're going to really enjoy. So keep watching, guys, because we've got a really good clip on ferrofluid. And this is a really interesting product made from billions of nano-sized magnets in a liquid form, okay? And then we've got shape memory alloys. Now, shape memory alloys are made from nickel and titanium. And my glasses that I'm wearing, I didn't realise, but when I was down in the optician's, I realised he put some heat over this. And in fact, nah, not these ones, they're the normal ones.
Oh no.
That was nearly made a mistake there, Shedhackers. This is the ones, I can't bend those, that's normal plastic, probably a steel. But this one, he heated it and adjusted the actual metal, and it reformed into the sort of shape I wanted.
Wow.
And to unform that, the shape he formed there, the chap there would have to heat this up to about 150 degrees, and you can reform it again, something like that. And that's made from nickel, Jake, and titanium.
Wow.
Yeah, very clever material. I nearly broke my own glasses then. Right, so we'll stick those on my head, and we'll come back to you in a minute, Shedhackers. Now for this, guys, I'm going to put some rubber gloves on, because the material I'm just about to pick up, which is a liquid, is really mucky, not very nice to touch. It says, so this is ferrofluid, okay, a magnetic type of fluid. Now this is weird stuff. It's, oh god, it's all over the place. It gets absolutely everywhere. It's horrible stuff, really. Can you see that, guys? Let's put it under the light. Now watch this, it's like an alien. Look, can you see that, guys?
Wow.
Can you see that? Get right near, Jake. Like an alien in there.
I don't want to get it on the camera.
Yeah. Damn, it's really not very nice stuff, but it's, oh look, it's, can you see how it's polarizing?
That's so cool.
Yeah, it is cool. It is cool. But you don't want to get it on your hand. It's really, oh look, in miniature. Can you see in miniature what it's doing? See those funny old stuff. So that's ferric fluid. I think that's, can you see that, Jane, in the light there? Look, look, look. Can you get right near it? Right near it. Get right near it. Look. Look, I'll turn it around. Ready? There. Really weird stuff.
That's so cool.
Oh, look at it changing. Yeah, well, I've just changed it. Ooh. I find it a bit creepy, but it's a bit alien-y, isn't it? Look at that on my hands, Jake. Anyway, so I'll take this off, because I'll have to chuck those, I bet. Not very good for the environment, is it? So, that's ferric fluid. I'll just put those to one side, those gloves. Keep there, Jake. So, thermochromic pigment. It's a plastic. And you can see, it just says 15 there. Can you see it says 15? There, I can see it. I don't know if you can.
Oh.
Just about. So therefore it's 15 degrees in this shed at the moment. Not very warm on a cold day in March 2020. Yeah. So yeah, that will change temperature. If I put my hand on it, it will go up to 18. Then you have this Fresnel lenses, they call it. They're really microscopic lenses used in a lot of 3D work, 3D plastic work. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Who does that look like, Jake?
You.
Oh, really? Mr. Carrot Man. Been eaten by a fish. Yeah, he's trying to fish, obviously. Okay, there's our little ferric fluid, weird stuff there. There's our little, our putty. Oh, I've got some of that stuff on my hand.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Okay, and then we've got this, that's a smart putty. It's a silicon-based material, a viscous elastomer polymer. Viscous relates to how thick the fluid is normally. So the more viscous, the more gooey it is, more thick it is, the thicker composition. Okay, a lenticular sheet, plastic with Fresnel lenses in it. This is used in security devices and in your credit card, and it often has an image within it, and it's very hard to copy, so they use it to stop thieves in their sophisticated attempts to copy credit cards. And it is a sophisticated optical effect, it says that there from my research. Ferric fluid made up of billions of nano-sized magnets can be used intelligently in some way. So you could actually change the composition of the material by putting in certain types of magnets, the size of magnets, and I think they can even electrically charge them, so they do different things on ferric fluid. Right, liquid crystals, quite old actually, from the 70s really, but it's still really clever. It's a carbon-based liquid that reacts to changes in voltage. Jake, you're not nudging me, so have you got a question?
No
questions at all. Okay, great. This one here, this is made from chameleon flakes. Now look at this, guys. Chameleon flakes, look. Now I bet you possibly more of the girls may recognize that. Where have they seen that? Have you got, go really near on it, Jake. Really.
Is that glitter?
Sort of. It looks a little bit like foundation, doesn't it? And they're cool. Look, on my hand, look. Can you see that on my hand? Can you see how glittery it is?
Yeah.
It's shiny. They put it in clothing, they put it in makeup, and it's chameleon nanoflakes. 10^-9, extremely small molecules or particles. Very much smaller you can see from in the human eye. Okay. Okay, moving on. So that's the nanoflakes there, chameleon nanoflakes. We did a liquid crystal. Smart textiles. I mean, textiles these days are amazing. They can react to different lights. They can react to different temperatures. They can even react to different voltages that you pass through them. So worth looking at smart textiles, guys. And these are the sort of materials that I think you're going to be becoming more and more used to seeing work and shape and changing colour in unusual ways as you get older. I've certainly noticed how coats have changed and they glow in the dark and do all sorts of funny things. And you can get it in, as I say, dyes and pigments, which is a form of dye. Okay. UV beads, and these react, if I put that outside, that react to to light and change colour into oranges and greens. You can see some difference in colours there. It's a polymer, based, and it reacts to ultraviolet light. You can see it's changing very slightly as I hold it near the window. Okay, we'll do some experiments on that maybe later. Then you've got thermochromic pigments, okay, which is actually in effect this. That's what that is. Okay, I put my hand on that and that will change colour. Can you see it changing colour? Not really. I've got this here. This is a very impressive metal. It's a metal alloy, a smart material, and it's from a turbine blade on a jet engine, a small jet engine, obviously. And these run at 50 to 60,000 revolutions per minute, sometimes much more. And this sort of metallurgy, that's the study of metals, is really impressive. And that can be very stable at high temperatures and not melt. And these are clever, very clever plastics. Not plastics, metals. Then this one, you may notice, going back to textiles again, guys, this is a carbon fibre matted material. And you can see all the little filaments there. Really clever stuff. And this is mixed with a liquid resin to make a hard material, which you know is carbon fibre. Jack, you okay?
Yeah.
You all right? Your neck's hurting, is it? Is it all this talking? A composite material, a mixture of materials is a composite. So when a carbon fibre is mixed with a resin, it is known as a composite, worth knowing. Oh, there's the glasses I nearly broke. Nanotechnology, 10 to the minus 9. It says, focus on that, Jake, there, 10 to the minus 9. And where these are the glasses, you can literally bend in all sorts of shapes and not break them, because it uses a smart material, what they call it, shape memory alloy, yeah, and it's super elastic alloy, okay, and alloy is a mixture of metals. SMA, look, smart materials react to they can relate to electricity, heat. And they're made from nickel and titanium. Okay. Yeah, very clever. And you've got these really modern plastics. This is a styrene covered in a mirror. And you can see, and I could cut that with a pair of scissors easily. Or a pair of pliers, look. So it's not glass. It's actually a plastic. Can you see, guys? Clever stuff, that. Just on a type of styrene or some sort of other polymer. Okay, moving on, we've got these sort of things. The sort of Christmas decorations that we talked about. And these are weird because they're almost liquid. It's almost a liquid, look. Not quite.
So it's like that putty?
Yeah, sort of. I've seen little men and ladies, not literally, made from this stuff. Toys, of course. Yeah, there you go. Very strange stuff. Okay, come back to you later with some more experiments.
Yeah, why are we listening to music in the music room?
Ah, right, well, I thought I'd just talk to you a little bit about some new and modern materials that perhaps the students and viewers may not know about. So I'll just turn it down a bit. There we go. So this is a monitor speaker. Lots of people have these for hi-fis, and they're the speakers. There's a large woofer at the side, 12-inch. And 2 6- or 7-inch mid-range and mid-range woofer speakers, and a little tweeter. And these all use very, very complex and modern textiles. And the textiles are mixed with polymers, so it's quite an interesting mixture of certain materials, as I say. And a lot of these speakers actually use, although this is covered by that polymerized cone there, they use a carbon fiber or even a Kevlar. And Kevlar and carbon fibre I use extensively because they're so strong and tough, particularly carbon fibre when it's mixed with a resin. But Kevlar, which is a yellow looking material looking similar to this, is woven into the speakers to form a very rigid and resilient and almost puncture proof coating to the speaker cone itself. Now, I thought I'd just show you something from my daughter. And there you go. What do you think I put that there for?
Some sort of protective vest.
Yes. Now, she uses this now and again on special events and days. And it says, armour provides ballistic protection from edge weapons. A ballistic actually usually means something that's travelling at high speed like a bullet. And that has, I can assure you, Kevlar in it. And Kevlar is known as aramid fibre, and it's extremely strong. It's similar in some ways to nylon, and it has nylon molecules in it, I think. It's spun into small fibres, as you can see, little those fibres there. And it's much stronger in certain situations than even steel, and has half the density of glass fibre, which the students and viewers may know a little bit about. Okay, so that's a little bit about carbon fibre and Kevlar, which is known as aromatic fibre. And we'll perhaps touch on that a little bit later in the shed, but I thought students might know a little bit about this today. Thank you. Hi guys, back to our Smart Materials special. Now these are apparently, you see them, expanding microfibers. Very small, 10 to the minus 9 apparently, very miniature.
It looks like
but
flour.
It looks like flour, doesn't it, Jane?
Yeah.
It may be a biodegradable polymer, who knows? We learnt in our last clip, didn't we? So apparently you heat it up, I don't think this is going to work, I heat it up and apparently they
expand something. Yeah.
Let's see. You see, not a lot going on there.
No.
No. Oh, yeah.
Oh, no, maybe they shouldn't be on fire.
Let's blow that out.
It's a bit smelly.
Working?
I mean, it smells weird. Like, I don't know, it smells kind of horrible.
Gold light.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Isn't it?
Oh, right, okay. Seems to have a shed hat problem. Oh, I can see.
Global warming.
They are expanding. But it is sort of expanding, but yeah, I don't think I've quite got that technique right. Okay, so what have we learned today? Oh, there's our polymorph, and it's hardened now. Look at that. That is clever. That's formed just exactly around my hand. It's even got imprint of my skin. Look, I bet you could take your imprint off that, your finger imprint. Look, you can see all the, that's remarkable. Hi viewers, just to recap on our experiments and some of my knowledge of smart materials. What do you think I'm doing there, Jake?
I'm not sure, but it must be something interesting.
That's a UV emitting LED, and this is glow in the dark pigment. So it's UV, I suppose, sensitive. So let's just see if it is. We'll just turn the light out.
Oh, cool.
Turn the other light out, I suppose. Oh, yeah, there you go. It works. Wow.
That's so cool.
Okay, and on that point, actually, this is fibre optic. That's fibre optic pieces. Put it on the UV light. If you come nearer, Jake, I'll turn the other light out. Ooh, oh, it's gone. Oh, I've turned the power out, that's why. Can you see, guys? Can you see, viewers?
Yeah.
That is data that can send enormous amounts of data very quickly. Very, very quickly. Clever stuff, actually, that. All right. So moving on round here. My colleague Mr. Roberts likes me saying. Moving on. That there is what, Jake?
It's a beer, but I can't drink beer, so
why have you got it? It's for me. That's very good of you. Well done. Now, actually, it says on it, it's as cool as the Rockies. And apparently, and it has, I put it in the fridge and it's got a thermochromic pigment in the paper and it's gone blue in colour. And when it warms up, look, you can see it changes colour. It's gone white. Ha! Isn't that clever? And it'll go blue again slowly. You see it's going bluer. It's going bluer.
Yes,
it's going bluer. Ooh. Right. So I'll have that later, if you'll let me, Jake, will you?
No.
You sure? I might have two of them. Okay, moving on. So we have... Oh, that's the polymorph I finished off with the last clip. And the liquid polymorph. And that hardens at 4 degrees. Quite interesting stuff. It's all polymer based, so it's a plastic. We have a new type of plastic there. That's the caprolactones. And that's used in another product I'll think of in a minute. Okay, moving on quickly. Oh, Shedhacks, that's clever.
Wait.
What's that?
Why have you got a hand gel?
Now, a lot of new products, cleaning products, have actually polymers in them, microfibers, and they help to clean the skin and things. The trouble is the microfibers also get into water, and they're not actually good for the environment. It's like that glitter you get in some products, and it all ends up in the water treatment works, not very good. And it's very hard to then purify. Shape memory alloys we looked at, didn't we? And nitinol wire, that's it. Nickel and titanium. Kevlar we talked about on the loudspeakers. And carbon fibre, which is mixed with resin to form a solid material, but very, very tough and can absorb lots of impact. Used in bumpers on a really fast car, like a sports car. Thermochromic, these are affected by heat. If I can get that to make a mark, hopefully. Will it make a mark? Let's hope. Yay! Okay, and used on thermometers. Turbine blades used a very clever alloy, set of alloys or mixture of alloys, and that's a mixture of metals. Okay, very clever, some of this stuff, and that can run at thousands of degrees centigrade. This is actually a photosensitive powder as well, you know. Smart textiles we talked about in the loudspeakers, and Kevlar in the policeman's jacket, police person's jacket. And you can have conductive threads that can actually carry voltage, so you can actually have switches and lights in actual clothing. That's what I mean by textiles, clothing and fabric. We've got the thermochromic reacts to light, yeah, so that changes colour in certain light. Okay, probably UV light as well. LCD, liquid crystal display from the 70s, but it's a carbon-based liquid that reacts to changes in voltage. Ferrofluid, look, there's that weird stuff. I don't like it. I really think it's weird. A little crimey. What have I done? I don't even want to touch it. Okay, coming back here. Looks like alien stuff to me. Whoa. I'll move that magnet, look. Ooh, I don't like it, Jake. Creepy. Oh no, I should have my hands on it. Oh no, I hate it. Right, and then we've got, why have I got that? I suppose that's an old smart material, I suppose. A couple of hundred years ago, they're going, ooh, that's weird. But it's not really a smart material. But a magnet making, obviously, that iron dial there move on the compass. And look, this is clever stuff. This Fresnel lenses on the 3D plastics. And then it's also including the sophisticated optical effects in this lenticular, there's the word, lenticular plastic sheet there, used in credit cards and all sorts of, secret work, keep data secret. We talked about the chameleon light changing powder used in plastics. Jake, yes, what's the question?
So why do we use these?
That makes my hand look really, really modern. Look at that. I might put some of that on my hands. Press my wife. She might think I'm a bit weird. Still, no change there. Right, okay. So, any questions, Jake?
Yeah, why would we use these? And if we can, What's the advantage of them?
Well, that's a really good question. Most of these have been developed for a specific reason. An awful lot of them are designed to do things in space where they can react to certain high temperatures or react to impact where they've been hit hard, or they can react to heat or light, or they can react to movement like this does. So I push down on it and the light actually, if I turn it off again, it conducts differently if I push down on it, this quantum tunneling material. So the resistance changes. Look, whoa. You know, I'm going a bit mad here. I don't know why I've got that. Oh yeah, I suppose that's got some smart gases in it, the old LED, and the LED gases illuminate at different voltages. We didn't have much luck with this.
I think they just replaced it with flour.
Yeah, I don't know. Polymorph, as we know. But yeah, I've got a little bit of research here, and it talks about, actually, interestingly, it's used in areas of the space shuttle, thermostats, where things can change state from liquid to solid to make a thermostat on a radiator work, different temperatures, hydraulic fittings for airlines, and it also talks about piezoelectric. Now, piezoelectric, I want my viewers, or our viewers, Jake, to have a look at what piezoelectric devices are used in. And that's a smart material, piezoelectric, and it's used in heating and cooling, and also in, I think, loudspeakers, the little ones in watches, sort of alarms, very thin. Piezoelectric, there's one for your research, guys. I just haven't got time to cover it all, but as a beginner's guide, there's a little bit there, yeah, where's it used? SMAs, smart materials are used all over the place. In aircraft, in microscopic mechanisms, all sorts of things. But it's a fascinating subject, I think, and it's smart materials. I think we're going to be seeing much more as we get into the future, much more commonly used. Probably see them in modern training shoes where they actually take an impact and then they soften up once the impact's gone. And we see that in some of the sort of metal battle jackets used in the army. Anyway, any more questions, Jake?
Yes, would oobleck be a smart material?
Oobleck, here we go. We know that is a starch-based polymer. Oobleck is one thing that perhaps the viewers could have a look at on the internet. Some really good stuff. Is it made from custard?
Can be, but not normally.
Yes, that's right. But that's starch-based. Well, viewers, I hope you've really enjoyed it for me and Jake today. I think we've tried to cover an awful lot, probably too much. But it's really great talking to you and getting your feedback. So thanks very much and come back to you soon.